Getting here with a torch.
I'm not saying nothing.
That was a jealousy laugh.
Are we ready?
I just usually need this.
That's fine, don't worry about it.
We good?
Good evening and welcome to the May 12, 2014 meeting of the Town of Scarborough Planning Board. Carol, would you take the role, please?
Ms. Owens, here. Mr. Bouvard.
Here.
Mr. Dupont.
Here.
Mr. Fellows.
Here.
Mr. Mazur. Mr. McGee.
Here.
Mr. Paul.
Here. With the absence of Mr. Mazur, let the record show that Mr. McGee is a voting member this evening. Our first item on the agenda is a consent item. Eastern Village Subdivision, Valentine Development LLC, request an amended subdivision approval for their sixth amendment. Mr. Chase.
Sure, thank you, Mr. Chair. As board members will recall, this item was before you at your last meeting. There were a number of details that needed to be ironed out, but ostensibly the board was okay with the general parameters of the proposal. Staff has received revised plans and letter dated May 6th that we have had an opportunity to review, and we are satisfied that all items have been addressed. At this time, we have prepared a motion for the board to consider.
The applicant is not here. Does the board have any comments or questions for staff? Seeing none, I would like to make a motion. I move to approve the application of Valentine Development LLC for the sixth amended plan of the Eastern Village subdivision, which includes the modification of the construction phasing plan, creation of 21 lots, and the establishment of three new housing types. All relevant prior conditions of approval shall continue to pertain to the build-out of the project. Is there a second?
Second.
We have a second. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? I show that to be unanimous. Before I move on to the next item this evening, there are a couple of announcements. Item number six, Sawgrass Subdivision Star Homes, Inc., requesting a final subdivision review for a 32-lot subdivision off Sawyer Road, has been tabled at the request of the applicant. And our item number seven, the Rock Church requests a site plan review for expansion of their parking at 66 Gorham Road, has also been tabled at the request of the applicant. And I do have one other item to get to prior to item five this evening, and that is actually the approval of minutes of April 22nd, 2014. I move to approve.
Second.
We have a second. Is there any discussion?
I'll be abstaining since I was not at that meeting.
All right, thank you. All in favor? I show that to be four approved, one abstention. Item number five this evening, Trillium Place, Eagle Woods Subdivision LLC, requests a final subdivision review for 11 single family lots off Ashmont Road. Mr. Chase.
Sure, thank you, Mr. Chairman. As board members may recall, this item's been before you a couple of times, once, I believe, sketch plans and a couple of preliminary reviews. At our past review, the board has raised some concerns or issues regarding the design of the stormwater detention pond, or at least the outlet to that. And this time, staff has reviewed the application, believe that all our prior issues or comments have been adequately addressed. We should have received a memo from Woodard and Curran, which they stated their issues have been addressed. Mr. Wendell also provided a memo which he identified three detailed comments that he wanted to see be addressed, but staff felt those could be pretty easily handled as a condition of approval if the board so inclined. And to that end, we have drafted a motion for the board to consider. That will turn back to you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much, Jay. Mr. Allen, good evening.
Good evening, members of the board. Thank you. My name is Lee Allen with Northeast Civil Solutions. I'm joined tonight by Steve Colucci, developer, his wife Susan, and their partner, Zach Greenfield. I think the only comment I'd like to make is an item that Jay and I have been discussing kind of behind the scenes here, and it's a modification of one of the notes on the plan. And that note had to do with the protection of the wetland buffer and what actually happens to that wetland buffer during construction, because obviously you're not going to put a fence or some fins out in the ground if there's a lot of earthwork going on at the same time. So what we're proposing and what we've added for language, and I'll just read it to you for so we're all on the same page. It says, prior to the commencement of earthwork activities, a 4-foot-high orange PVC construction fence shall be erected along the wetland buffer to protect the wetlands during construction. All permanent pins and hardscape features will be set on each lot prior to obtaining a certificate of occupancy. And that is just to protect that back area during construction. Obviously, before the building's turned over, you know, those pins, and I think in this case, we're proposing split rail fences along that edge would be in place. With that, as Jay mentioned, there's a few minor things to work out with Mr. Wendell. Those have been done as of today. They will be in his office tomorrow morning. Other than that, I'll turn it back to you with any questions.
All right, thank you, Lee. John?
Question, do you have permits all in place?
Yes, I failed to mention that in my introduction. We have received a copy.
That's the only question I have.
Thank you. Mark?
Am I correct in my understanding that no wetlands are included in the open space? That we're not counting wetland areas for the open space requirement?
No, the wetlands are within the open space. So that's the conservation subdivision calls for 50% of the land to be maintained as open space. And sort of the first priority, if you will, of that open space is preservation of the wetlands.
Okay. I guess I was misreading the plan then.
Yeah, I believe I think we were required 50%. I think we're at 65% open space.
Yeah, no, I wasn't really concerned about the percentage. I just wanted to make sure I understood the.
But I think what you may be misunderstanding, there's no wetlands on any of the lots. The lots are on.
No, I understand that as well. Thanks.
Okay.
This has been fairly well vetted. We appreciate all the efforts of the applicant in getting through all the items that we've had, and we know that staff has had as well. And it's good to see us moving along to this point, and I think everything has pretty well been taken care of. So, once again, I would like to make a motion that the Planning Board approve the application of Woods Ed Scarborough LLC under Chapter 406 of the Town of Scarborough Subdivision Ordinance for the final subdivision plan for the Trillium Place subdivision with the following findings, waiver, and conditions. Findings. The applicant proposes an 11-lot residential subdivision with access off Ashmont Road. The residential subdivision is located within the rural farming district and has been designed in accordance with the conservation subdivision standards as a conservation subdivision. The Planning Board finds that the subdivision meets the required conservation subdivision design standards with residential lots designed to meet the space and bulk regulations of Section 7A and with an excess of 50% open space principally designed to conserve wetlands and natural areas. The Planning Board has reviewed the applicant's proposed plan and related materials as submitted and finds that the final subdivision plan meets the performance standards of Section 4 and 6 of the subdivision ordinance with the following waiver and conditions. Given the limited number of lots within the subdivision and the dead-end road design, the Planning Board waives the 24-foot pavement width required for residential access streets and approves a 22-foot-wide paved travelway. Conditions. The subdivision shall be constructed in accordance with the subdivision plans entitled Trillium Place Subdivision, as prepared by Northeast Civil Solutions Incorporated, dated 4/18/14, to be revised in accordance with the comments addressed in Jim Wendell's May 7th letter.
prior to the release of the attested final subdivision plan to the applicant for recording at the Cumberland County Register of Deeds, the applicant shall pay the required traffic impact fees. Oak Hill, $1,510. Dunston, $9,814. Higas, $4,950. Payne Road, Zone 3, $998.10. Prior to the release of the attested final subdivision plan to the applicant for recording at the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds, the applicant shall execute and record all documentation necessary to comply with the town's post-construction stormwater infrastructure management ordinance. A recreation contribution in the amount of $250 shall be paid on a lot-by-lot basis prior to the issuance of a building permit. Prior to the start of construction, the no-disturb wetland setback areas and cemetery shall be clearly delineated in accordance with town staff. Is there a second? We have a second.
I ask one question, and I'm not sure if you mentioned this in there. Is it possible to have the impact fees split so that we pay 1/11 prior to each building permit as well?
That's a question for staff.
Typically, they're paid prior to the release of the Mylar. That's been the policy of the board, and I have to dig through the ordinance to figure out if that's been just the standing policy of the board or if that's per requirement. Though upon talking it through, there have been other instances where the board has considered sort of a schedule of payment. So that's certainly something the board could consider. Staff could help support the board if they want to consider amending their standing policy on that item.
Is this the first time that the board or the staff has had this request?
I don't believe so. I believe we've had it on other projects.
Wait, yeah, is it the first time you've asked for it for this project?
On this project.
On this project right here. This is the first time we've heard about it as we're voting for the final approval. That's fine. Okay.
We'll talk with impact fees.
Yes, traffic impact fees.
Before we continue to discuss, I'm not sure if I had a second.
Second.
Now we have a second. Thank you.
Now we can discuss.
Now we can discuss. So I don't know what other people's thoughts are. I understand Ms. Otless's concern in terms of the fact that we're now at the 11th and a half hour, and we're just getting this as an item to address. How do other board members feel? If anybody would like to weigh in?
That was a question. I have a suggestion, if it's possible. This is my concern. Is there a way that we can pass this with a condition that staff answered that question, and if there's any difficulty, come to the chair? You know, I don't know how that all happens. It happens from time to time.
I think that's an excellent solution. Staff doesn't foresee any problem working with the applicant. I think, you know, we can come to a reasonable solution on it. It's not unprecedented. It hasn't happened in a while, but it's not unprecedented. Staff would be comfortable considering.
Yes.
I believe this would have to be an amendment. To the motion.
Absolutely.
I would agree.
Exactly.
Is the board?
Yep.
I guess what I need to do is to hold on 1 second.
Okay.
I'm going to amend my original motion. I'm not going to read it in entirety, but I have two changes to make. One change has to do with the subdivision plans. I indicated earlier that they were dated 4/18. They are actually dated today, 5/12/14. So we'll correct that date for the record. And I am going to amend my condition number 2, and I am going to scratch out the words, pay the required traffic impact fees, and substitute, shall coordinate with town staff on a schedule of payment of the traffic impact fees. Everybody okay with that?
Fine. I'll second the amended motion as a point of discussion, I think.
Okay.
Should we consider putting the amount of time in which the fees must be paid, whether the schedule is met or not, but I don't want to see this extend out 2 years down the road. You know, is it reasonable to say within a 6 month period, within a 12 month period, these fees need to be paid?
That was the intent of letting staff make that decision.
I just wanted to know if the board should give staff general direction based on the time frame linked to the fees being high.
I can appreciate that as well. Any comments or thoughts on that?
I appreciate the comment, but I personally am comfortable delegating that to staff with the understanding that staff will make every effort to ensure timely payment arrangement.
Are you comfortable?
Yeah, you brought it up as a point of discussion.
I got you. So it's fine.
That's fine. I'm fine.
I'm comfortable, John.
Okay.
As already stated, it's August. You're fine with it. So again, we have a motion. We have a second. Any other discussion? Great point. I would ask staff to note Mr. McGee's concern. Seeing none, all in favor?
Point of order.
As amended, yes. Dave?
You need to vote on the amendment first.
Oops, pardon me. Thank you. I appreciate that. Here we go. All of these rules. So,
I was in.
I know. So we're going to vote on the amendment first before we vote on the motion. So all in favor of the amendment to the motion? I show that to be unanimous. Now, all in favor of the motion? And I show that to be unanimous as well.
Thank you very much.
Awesome. Again, items number 6 and 7 have been tabled, so we'll be moving on to item number 8. Piper Shores, Maine Life Care Retirement Community, Inc. requests a site plan amendment for improvements to the generator system at the site on Piper Road. Mr. Chase.
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Found my notes here. As just noted, the applicant is seeking to expand their existing generator pad and to add a shed to house electronic components associated with the generator. As board members will note, this site is subject to a contract zone. Therefore, all changes to the site plan are required to come back to the board for approval. While the proposal is fairly small in terms of the scale and scope of the overall development, one item that the board did want to bring to the board's attention is that the location of the shed will actually eliminate 2 parking spaces on site. The site does have in excess parking in terms of the town's minimum standards, but I know parking has been a point of discussion with the board in recent past, and so I just thought that was worth bringing to the board's attention. Staff has drafted a motion for the board's consideration, should you get to that point during this evening's deliberation. Though I'm not sure I'm seeing anyone from the applicant's party here to discuss the item at this time, but the board can decide to carry on or to whatever you choose to do.
Is no one from the applicant here? Verify that. Does not appear to be. I would move that we table this until the applicant can be present.
I'll second.
We have a second.
That was me speaking in the chair.
Move to table it.
Move to table it.
Second.
We have a second. Any discussion? All in favor? I show that to be unanimous as well. At 700 Gallery Boulevard. Mr. Chase.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let's see, board members will recall seeing this one a couple of times in the past year. As long ago as maybe 10 months ago or so, we reviewed it for a preload application where the site ostensibly required a lot of preload prior to construction. So the applicant came and talked to you about the general parameters of the development at that time. More recently, there before you in the wintertime for a sketch plan review of the proposal. Subsequent to that sketch plan, they have gone through our pre-application review process and addressed many of the issues that the board members raised during sketch plan with regards to access, landscaping, pedestrian ways, overall coordination with the Scarborough Gallery. Just by a brief way of background, this is the last remaining site in the gallery of subdivision, referred to as lot number 7. It was basically in between Lowe's and the Walmart site. And as I mentioned, based on the direction the board provided staff and the applicant at sketch plan, we conducted a pre-application review process, and ostensibly the applicant has responded to those items, and staff is relatively comfortable and pleased with the modifications that have been made to date. We have a few remaining comments, but certainly things that can be worked out as we go along, recognizing that to date we haven't received our architectural details, which will be a critical component prior to any formal approval by the board. So tonight, really just a continuing discussion about the site plan. One item that staff is remiss that I forgot to put in our comments, has to do with the location of a bus stop. Since the inception of Scarborough Boulevard or the Scarborough Gallery subdivision, the South Portland Transit District runs a bus line pretty frequently used, according to the folks at South Portland, that runs across Gallery Boulevard and actually makes two stops along the frontage of this lot. And so staff thinks it would be good if we could have an opportunity to continue to work with the applicant on identifying a good location to put a pad where a potential shelter could go, which would be the shelter provided by the South Portland Transit folks. So we'd like to coordinate with the applicant moving forward on that, if everyone's amenable to that. With that, as I said, staff's provide you a list of comments. You should have also received comments from Woodard and Kern on this issue as well. And with that, I would turn it back to you.
Thank you very much. Good evening, Ms. Sinclair.
Good evening. My name is Nancy Sinclair. We're from Sinclair Associates, and we're here tonight on behalf of Waterstone Scarborough LLC. The name is a little bit different than what you saw in the prior materials in that the LLC just recently purchased the property. It's the same players, same
address, contact information, some same people, but they do have an LLC for this particular site. So it is Scarborough Waterstone, a Waterstone Scarborough LLC. As Jay had mentioned, we were about last week when we focused on the end of January at the time. I'm supposed to talk up a little bit. At the end of January, we last before you folks with a sketch plan. Looked relatively similar to this, but we have made a fair amount of changes to the internal circulation, islands, and parking areas. The other most notable change is with the location of the restaurant and Retail E, which is the small retail building. Those two buildings had set back a bit from Gallery Boulevard. One of the comments that we had received from you folks was to put those buildings up as close as feasible to the boulevard to give more of a street presence for this project. So that's a major change sort of with the situation of the buildings. The main building with the four tenant spaces in it remains generally at the same location on the site. As Jay had noted, we were before the board back in August of last year. Let's talk a little bit about the preload and surcharge. And if you've been by the site, you'll see that there's been quite a bit of activity going on. That preload and surcharge is just about completed. We had expected it would be done this week, but I think it's probably going to be towards the end of this week, or perhaps early into the next. The elevations that you see there, I wanted you all to know, the top of that surcharge is about 9 to 9.5 feet above the finished floor elevation of the proposed building. So basically, we've got the preload that sets the site essentially at grade for the building, but then we have the additional surcharge of materials in order to preload the site. So it's a big, tall pile of material right now. We didn't get the grades wrong, that is what what it is, but that is going to actually be settling for a period of probably between 10 and 12 months. So we're here before you tonight to talk a little bit about the site plan, which once that preload settles, then we can be able to go forward with construction. So what we'd like to do is get all of the necessary reviews out of the way throughout this timeline so that once the material is ready to come off, we can move forward right into construction and have a seamless process for that. So I wanted to talk a little bit about the actual plan and the layout. As you note in the application materials, there are a couple of waivers that we've asked for. One is with regard to parking. The ordinance requirements for retail use are based on 4 spaces per 1,000 square feet. Our plan provides 3.6 spaces per 1,000 square feet for the main four retail buildings. And that accommodates about a 10% overlap for a customer who would come to one building, one tenant, and go to the next and shop at the same facility, but not move their parking. So based on that, we have about a 10% shared parking ratio that we're asking for you folks to consider. Because of the location of Retail E, the small building up adjacent to Gallery Boulevard, we are providing the requisite number of parking spaces at 4 spaces per 1,000, which equates to about 9 parking spaces for that building. The restaurant, as you know, the ordinance requires, parking based on the number of items associated with a restaurant, the number of seats, the number of employees, counter space, waiting area, those types of things. We've made some assumptions with regard to that, and so we have provided parking for that area based on an anticipated restaurant tenant. We do not have a restaurant tenant at this point. We also don't have tenants for the small retail building. The four main buildings do have tenants that are on board or in line to come on board for that. So one of the comments that Jay had raised as part of his review is a discussion to talk a little bit about perhaps phasing the approval. And so that we would focus on the elements of the main building, the parking, the access to the site associated with that, but perhaps leave a second phase so that once we had a tenant identified, we could further look at the specifics of the number of employees in the restaurant, those types of things. So we'd like to talk to you a little bit about that tonight as well. From a stormwater management perspective, this project is part of an overall master plan for stormwater that was done back in 2005 when the original Scarborough Gallery subdivision was approved. The site has a pond that is actually on the site, which is a wet pond. It picks up drainage from Gallery Boulevard, and it was designed to pick up a portion of this site as well. There's a storm drain run that runs along the westerly side of the property that comes from Gallery Boulevard. As part of our program, one of the things that we looked at was part of the site will actually connect into that drain line and discharge into that pond. But there are other portions of the site that will actually discharge from the Gallery Boulevard in this location here, as well as some of it will come back towards the southern side of the property into the conservation easement area. Those, that sort of master planning, that overview for stormwater was all contemplated as part of the original analysis. So what we've done, and you'll see in the application materials, is we've done a comparison between the two for that. The areas that are going underneath Gallery Boulevard are actually being treated with biocells. There are 10 bioretention cells that are proposed on the site. They are in the longitudinal islands that are located along the parking area. There's actually three of them there. There's a couple scattered by the primary entrance. There's a couple on the secondary entrance. And there's actually a couple along the side of the building, the western side of the building. So the plantings that you see on the landscape plan are all part of that program for the plant materials that will function well in a bioretention cell. The analysis shows all of the piping and design to collect the water that overflows from those areas and goes out primarily through the existing culvert that's under Gallery Boulevard. So we did not provide, as part of our application materials, a formal stormwater model for the site, given the fact that we were following the general approach that was done back in 2005. So that is the second item that we were asking for a waiver on as part of this review process for you folks to consider. Sort of back to the longitudinal islands, they do form an opportunity not only to provide treatment for stormwater, but they do break up the parking area and provide opportunities for three major sidewalk connectors that link between the main building up to the internal access drive. There's a new sidewalk that runs along the internal access drive, and then we have connection points to Gallery Boulevard through the area of the restaurant and the small retail. Those three connection points, as Jake had mentioned earlier about a possible location for a bus shelter, I think we have ample opportunities to site a bus shelter at one of those logical connection points. So we'd certainly be willing to work with staff to further pursue that to make sure we get it sited in the correct location for the bus system as well. So with that, I will turn it over to you folks asking questions that you may have.
Thank you, Nancy. Susan, would you like to start us?
I'm sorry, I can't hear anything. Speaking of me.
Yes.
I wasn't here when it was first presented, so bear with me. The part of the, I realize that there is not going to be, you're requesting that there not be a national stormwater plan.
Well,
yeah. But I don't quite understand. The part that is not going to flow into the existing wet pond is going to go out into Gallery Boulevard and what?
As part of the master plan for Scarborough Gallery, if you remember, there is a large stormwater management area that's on the opposite side of Gallery Boulevard. That was intended to pick up the flow coming from this lot as well as Gallery Boulevard.
Okay. So that was sized for this plan at this intensity.
Right.
Okay. No, I don't have a question. There is a question to staff. One of the things that has consistently concerned me about these sea of, by the way, this is less of a sea of non-landscaped parking, thank you. But lighting is important. That's been checked all out by staff. Do you have any problems or questions about it? Because I don't begin to understand the schematic.
Sure, and maybe the applicant can provide a little bit more detail, but one of the items that was in the narrative and in the plans was they are really seeking to coordinate with the other large tenants in the area, Walmart and Lowe's, which so typically our standards seek to have pole heights at about 25 feet in if I'm recalling correctly, Lowe's and Walmart have pole heights at 40 feet for the sort of general lighting, but then they have more pedestrian scale lighting along their landscape sidewalk aisles, which they're proposing to do here. So there is a request to have 40-foot poles in some locations, but there will be, as noted, those pedestrian scale lights along the walkway. You know, it's really a question to the board if you're, what your interest primarily serves. Is it coordination throughout the site and the subdivision, or, do you want to try to adhere to the sort of current practice of 25 feet? Staff certainly supports whichever direction the board goes, but coordination was certainly a significant issue through the subdivision review process back many years, looking through that documentation and those approval processes. So, hopefully that answers.
Well, yes and no, it does, but I don't understand it all, but that's okay. The standard that was set by the previous development was it what? 40?
What's existing at the other large tenants is 40, yes.
And there are places on this one where we're going to not have 40, it's going to be down to 20.
There'll be a mix. There'll be the 40 in the certain locations, but in the more pedestrian areas, there'll be the shorter height poles.
So, because other than the fact that it might not look like the rest of Gallery Boulevard, is there a reason that we need to keep the 40?
The concern was that by going back to all the 25s, the shorter pole heights end up having many more poles. And because we are in between two that do have the higher poles, we just felt it wasn't
going to be very consistent. That answers my question. Thank you. Now, the treatment that's going to be in the middle of the parking area, the water treatment, I know I at one point knew how that worked, but I don't remember. But I'm just wondering, there's not going to be any landscaping on the actual.
These are bioretention cells. They're not grass under rain soil filters, so they do have landscaping within them. So there will be trees and shrubs all along the extent of the bioretention cells.
Okay.
Those bioretention cells are roughly the cell part of it, if you will, is an impression that's about 6 inches deep. And so all of the plantings that you see on the landscape plan, those were all selected by the landscape architect in order to do well in that water regime, if you will. On the ends of the bioretention cells are more of a traditional upland type landscaping that you would see with the larger trees, those types of things. But through the bioretention cell, it's the plantings that's the mixed shrubbery and those types of things.
In theory, I like the idea a great deal. When you come the next time, could we have something that I can actually read, that, and the landscape lady, something that I can actually read? This is so tiny, I can't, in terms of what's going on.
Sure.
Okay. Maybe one of those, but that's, I don't know. I can't follow exactly what you're going to have there, and I would like to know more about it.
Absolutely.
And I have no problems with the parking question. I really like the fact that those two outbuildings have been moved a great deal closer to the boulevard. It looks great to me. And the crosswalk thing, I'm going to leave that to our chair, who is the one who's the crosswalk.
Thank you.
The copies are small, so could you just point out where you have stop signs or stops in your traffic patterns on the property where the parking areas more specifically?
Everywhere, would you see this little bar right here?
Yeah, they're hard to see, so is that you could just. My concern, I'll cut to the chase, the concern is the entrance across from the Lowe's. If that, no, the other one.
This
two, yes. That first primary corner, can you just point to me where the stops are?
Sure. There's a stop here at Gallery Boulevard. There is a stop here. There is a stop here. So that vehicles that are exiting this bay stop, vehicles that are exiting this bay have the right of way over this traffic, but all stop here. And then come out onto the sort of central entrance. That theme is carried through on every one of those as you come down through.
Okay, so there's no stuff where the crosswalk is, that's the trees, or retail eat.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's no stop
there's
there.
There's a stop there.
I don't know.
In here?
Yeah.
No, not on the main access drive, there's not.
Okay, but I guess my concern, what if you make, so let's just say you take your car down, and I'm going to shoot across to, I guess that'd be about there, I think you'd be okay. All right. And any ideas of stacking, whether or not you have big concerns about stacking in these areas more specifically?
Typically, you only address stacking at a primary entrance and exit to a site, not usually internally within a parking field, because there's lots of opportunities for people to go through the different bays, et cetera. So, right here, that would be primary location for stacking. We reviewed that. Tom Worrell is the traffic engineer on this project. We reviewed the layout with Tom with regard to making sure we've got sufficient stacking depth. And, in light of the comments that the board had made at the last meeting, we reviewed the layout with Tom to make sure that, you know, we're doing the best that we could with the entrance there.
And I guess my only other question would be, when you go up to the crosswalk, right down by the bottom, retail D, yeah, is there a reason there might not be a crosswalk for those? Yeah, because below it, I notice you got crosswalks across. No, right between what you're showing, the purple bushes. Yeah, why not crosswalk to that corner? So I would think a lot of people that park in that lower area would tend to take the path of least resistance to the sidewalk and go kind of, you know, go from that purple bush across.
Yeah.
There you go. That's the spot. That, I don't know if that's a consideration or if that's, you know, if they have to walk the extra 15 feet, no big deal, but if you had thought about putting them there.
We hadn't anticipated it. It doesn't connect to a sidewalk in
that
location.
Oh, there's no sidewalk there?
No, the sidewalk is here.
I'm sorry, well, I guess I'm sorry. In front of the sidewalk in front of retail D is
what we're oh, the vestibule area?
Yeah.
We could put one in there. That was something that the board wished to have added.
And the, I like what you did with the retail E and restaurant F. That's better than what we saw last time. The parking was good. And I have no problem with the parking waiver for the lease of response. That's all for my comments.
Thank you.
Dave?
Thank you. The last time you were here, I had some issues really hard to. I do like what you've done with the restaurant and the small retail building. I'm assuming that's all in colors with the exception of two exits.
That is correct.
Okay. Yeah, I like that a lot better in the parking scheme for those two buildings. I'm a little concerned with the parking way at the eastern end of the parking lot. It reminds me of the parking for Lowe's across the road, where they have a similar row of parking way at the end, which nobody uses. My concern is if anybody ever parks there, would be crossing that roadway, because that is the main roadway, right?
It's you can drive through there. We anticipate that the primary access for customers coming in and out of the site is here, so that folks can feed in to these areas here. Obviously, we do have access here. One of the things that I think we've noted in our prior discussion and in the application materials is this area we'd like to have signage that identifies this is more of a truck area, loading area. We can't preclude people from coming in and out of there, and there may be occasions when a customer needs to come back to the back of the building there. So we've designed it so that people can, but we really want to through signage, and you'll see that the main sign is up here. This is the primary entrance to the site, so customers will be coming in and expect in this area here as well.
No, I see that, but I think you will also miss a certain amount of traffic on this section here as well. But you're required to have some of the parking spaces for folks, I understand. Last time, also, I raised the issue of trucks using all three entrances. Is that still the plan?
The circulation for the truck route does allow access for all of the entrances. The truck can get in and out of all of them. There are docks, here, and here. So the truck circulation through the dock area is actually two-way. So you can have our primary use would be here, but you'll see that this island here is wider to allow a truck to come out and use the primary inside of the truck if it needs to.
Even large trailer trucks?
Yes.
Is that the same situation with Walmart? Or do they have a separate truck entrance?
Walmart's trucks come in and out on both sides. Yes.
Both sides. All I can think of is a week before Christmas and full parking lot with big trucks coming in and out on that main entrance. I guess you can't prohibit them from that, but I guess I'm trying to encourage them to use the eastern entrance.
I certainly understand, and a lot of times the retailers can instruct their drivers to appropriate locations for their entrances and how to maneuver through the site. But we do have a dock here on this side that would require that an exiting vehicle come through that area. So there's not much we can do with that. There is an area here for smaller vehicles that they could turn around behind the building and wouldn't have to come out, but we do have that option for them to exit through the site.
And snow removal, will it all be on site, kept on site, or?
Typically what happens in retail is that if you get a heavy snow early on in the season where you've got peak shopping before Christmas, a lot of times that will be removed from the site to maintain parking for the peak demands. But as it goes sort of past the Christmas peak, a lot of times what you see is an area dedicated for snow storage. And I knew on the way over here that I had not shown that on the plan, but we do need to provide that for you. And my vision for that is that these areas here, they would be, if you look at the double bays, towards the end of the double bay, sort of in the middle parking, I envision that that would probably be a logical place for snow storage. We don't want to be pushing snow this way, because that's where the access to the bioretention cells are. We can push snow this way, because it's a raised curb prohibiting flow from the air, so we could do that as well. But we will show that for you, so you have that goes in here.
All right, thank you.
Thanks, Dave. Court? Thanks. Already been a lot of good comments and questions, and I concur with my colleagues the board and appreciating moving the outbuildings out closer to the street. And the overall circulation is definitely improved. I'll look forward to seeing, in addition to the building architecture, some detail on the landscape buffering, as noted in the comments as well. And then you're passing that along to the architect. I think I'm okay with a coordinated approach to the lighting, provided that I think it's sort of common sense under the circumstances. I think it helps to cut down on the number of poles. I'm also okay with the requested parking waiver. On these types of projects, I'm almost always in favor of reducing parking. They tend to get designed and built for some mythical peak time, which is hardly ever realized. We have a landscape lady and we have a crosswalk man here, and I hope maybe someday I'll be known as the reduced parking guy. But I think I can aspire to that. But I think there are spaces in these developments that the whole areas that are almost never used. And along those lines, what I'm thinking of, and this is just kind of a friendly suggestion, but one of the experiences I've had in a couple of the other properties in the Gallery Boulevard area is that somewhat, I mean, it's related to a good thing, which is that there's some good landscaping, and sometimes it's hard to find your way, feel your way from where you're parked to where you can actually get out on the Gallery Boulevard. And I've had experiences where I'm sort of driving around trying to find my way out to where the actual exit is. And to the extent that the applicant might consider some sort of low-key attractive wayfinding signage that sort of directs to where the exits are, that might be helpful. I don't know whether others would agree. I'm also okay with the waiver request associated with the stormwater model, given that this is all still part of that original master plan. And I'm also okay with a phased approval approach. I don't know whether we need to discuss that in details or in terms of what that would actually look like. But I would be okay with that in principle. That's all I've got.
Thanks. John?
I like being next to last because basically every question I have has been answered. Thank you, guys, board members. And we'll leave the crosswalks to you, Al.
I'm sorry?
I'm all done. Everybody's already answered my question.
All right.
And I'll leave the crosswalks to you.
There you go. I'm not going to say much about it tonight, actually. One thing I did not do a little bit early and I want to do before I finish with my comments would be, this is an item that we offer public comment on. Having seen who's in the audience, I'm not anticipating any, but if anybody would like to make a comment about this, we encourage them to approach the mic and do so at this time. Feeling pretty confident that was the way it was going to go, but I wanted to make sure I did cover that. Nancy, I do have a few things, and I will also weigh in as well. The lighting I'm okay with. The waiver on the storm water I am okay with. Obviously, I'm going to be curious to see what your architectural is going to start to look like. The entryway is way better. Thank you for that. In terms of the lighting with the pole situation the way that it is, I'm good with that too. I guess I would be curious to see how you might consider, I'll call, circuiting that lighting, because I am, beyond being the sidewalk guy, I'm the reduced lighting guy as well. And I appreciate that we do need to have enough lighting for safety while the building is occupied. But in those unoccupied times, I would love to see at least those 40-foot lights out, unless they're absolutely needed for safety purposes, and hope that the shorter lighting would take care of any safety issues that we may have. So I throw that out as a suggestion and ask that you work with your electrical engineers in terms of that and see if we can do anything with that. In terms of the parking, I am not only okay with the shared parking, but I'm going to throw another item out to you as a one to think. But again, we do have ordinances that require certain amounts of parking. I get that. We see facilities or sites like this that have this tremendous amount of parking that rarely ever is used in full. There are 30 spaces on what I'll call the north side of this lot along Gallery Boulevard. There's 22 spaces right along the boulevard and two sections of four closest to the truck entrance. I'm going to suggest that they be shown on the plan for potential future build-out, but not necessarily paved over at this time, and be considered something that might get paved only if you need them in the future. It actually eliminates some of that parking, because I could be wrong, but that's a ton of parking that you got there, and I wonder just how much we really need all of it. Just a consideration. I'm not suggesting that you do it. I'm just asking you to think how that might impact your site plan, your pedestrian travel, where you think people are going to park or whatever. But that just seems like easy pickings for me, where we could actually reduce some parking potentially, but not lose the ability of it.
just want to clarify what you were talking about.
Absolutely.
Here?
Yes, ma'am. That's exactly the ones I'm suggesting.
I'll certainly review that with the applicant. The only caveat that I have is that the tenant and retailer may weigh in on that. But certainly, if we can, we would approach it that way.
No, I understand. I'm just, again, I go across the street a lot. And on very, very busy days, I don't think 50% of that lot is actually being used. So, you know, we have a tendency to put a lot of parking up there. And so some shared parking, I think, makes a lot of sense. And if we can minimize some, I think that makes sense too. So if that tenant has a problem, but you find another area that might make sense, I would certainly be willing to listen to that.
Yeah.
It might actually use some snow storage. And I think that those are the items that I have at this time this evening. So I think that's it. The rest of the board's okay?
Okay.
Yes.
I just want to let you know, I wouldn't mind seeing those two spots of four just disappear completely. I think they're awkward. You've got people on both sides potentially backing out to a main area, and they disappeared. I wouldn't say anything. So that would just be my two cents. And I'm okay with the stormwater. I don't think they caught it in their way.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, can I just add something? I think Jay mentioned it, but I just did want to follow up with you folks. Our program for this review is to sort of split the review into two parts. And so, you know, we're here tonight talking to you folks about the site aspects of the plan. But we do intend to have the architect come and meet with you, present his plans, the building colors, materials, the elevations, all of that information. We thought that that might be a logical topic for the next meeting that we meet with you folks. So I just wanted to kind of put that out there so you didn't think we skipped over it.
When you say phasing, are you thinking in terms of a build out of A, B, C, and D, but not too small, and the associated parking fields, or?
Our goal would be that build out would actually be all together, but we don't have tenants for the restaurant, which is F or E at this point, mm-hmm. which is the small retail building. So depending on the timing, if those tenants came on board in the short term, and certainly we go through the full site plan review and not look at a phase. But what we're looking at right now is because we don't have the details of that, we don't have a footprint, we don't have architectural elevations, those types of things, we thought it might be logical to phase our review and discussion of that so that we would, Jay had requested in the staff comments to have sort of phase of the plan. So you would see what was included in the approval. It would be the concrete information that, you know, we knew wasn't going to change if we had a different tenant.
Right. Okay. Yeah, I don't think that that's a problem. Anything else? Oh, Susie, sorry.
It just dawned on me. I don't know where the architect is in the process of creating. The renderings and drawings, but it would be really nice if there was a way that this, maybe it's already being thought that way, but if this could be done in a way that has a unifying architectural umbrella. You know, we have Walmart that is a single concept, we have Lowe's, which is a single concept, now we have this multiple use building which will have some kind of a singular concept. It would be nice if the outer buildings, even though we don't necessarily know just what size or what it's going to be, but we can perhaps at the very beginning put some kind of materials out there that are going to match the larger building so that it comes up. Let's face it, I've got, what's the name of the one? Pingo, Cabela's.
New England Expeditions,
you know, that whole idea that there is a sense of unity about that whole development. I'd like to see something come in that, at least if not in great detail, but overall gives the sense that this is
one of the
Thank you.
applicant set?
I am.
All right. Look forward to seeing you back.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, if I might, before we move to the next item, I just, I know we had moved past the Piper Shores item because the applicant wasn't here, and as I contemplate that, I realized that the two items that were tabled before were not, that wasn't conveyed to the applicant, so the board will be amenable to certainly move back to Piper Shores. I know the applicant is here now, probably appropriate.
I would gladly bring that up to the board, but I think that I would like to circle back around to it as we follow our agenda and then get back then at the board services.
Given that we've only got one other
item. One other item, that's right. So I'd like to suggest that we go to 10 and then circle back.
Our item, next item is Three Commercial LLC requests a site plan amendment for a site at Three Commercial Road. Mr. Chase.
Sure, yep. As you just noted, this is an application for a site plan amendment at Three Commercial Road. The applicant is proposing to add 14 additional parking spaces to the lot. It is located within the industrial district. The other significant component to the application is the applicant's looking to cease the use of the current on-site subsurface wastewater disposal and to connect to the public sanitary district. This time, just like the applicant to provide an update as to any conversations that may have had with the sanitary district towards that end. Steps. You know, that's by and large our staff comments at this time. We have prepared a motion if the board is so inclined at the conclusion of your discussion.
Thank you, Jim. Good evening.
Good evening to the board. Mr. Chairman, Steve Bushy from FST. I'm here representing Mr. Jesse Abbott, who's looking to acquire the property at Three Commercial. I'm going to give you a quick overview here on this aerial map. I apologize, it's in black and white. Color printer failed on me here. The property located right here, Pleasant Hill Road, Rigby Road is the access point coming off Commercial. Pond View Drive, slightly to the east. Crowds Pond, located over here, further to the east. What was formerly I know it as Rich School and Die, out behind here. Municipal boundary, slightly to the north with South Portland. So, more or less a out-of-the-way location. Building has been occupied by McGrady Roofing. The building's about 36,000 square feet in size. Industrial-type setting. It's in the industrial zone. Probably most people around don't know much about that building or that area. My client's looking to acquire the property. McGrady Roofing is moving out of the building, but there are a couple of smaller industrial type tenants uses they're looking to occupy it, and my client is just seeking to create a little bit more parking on the property, get upwards over to 40 spaces. We are looking for a waiver of parking to allow just that 40. It certainly has not been in the past an issue with parking capacity on the property, and we don't foresee that it will be in the future, but we would like to provide just a little bit more parking on the back side of the property. There'll be multiple tenants, and we'd like to have close proximity to some of the uses. I'll show you the site plan. So the building, right here, long rectangular shape, you have the access that comes in. Towards the south side is the predominant area where all the parking is today. There's some loading docks. As you can see here in this aerial photograph, you'll go up there today. In fact, you see a number of vehicles parked at the loading docks and so forth. McGrady Roofing has used it in that manner. The proposal is to provide 10 more spaces over on the rear side here. We have some basically undeveloped space behind the building, which abuts up against a Portland Water District utility right of way. The district has their 36-inch transmission main that travels over towards Pondview from the Rigby area. And that will remain obviously in place. There is
additional access to the building out through the Rich Tool and Die property as well. That will remain in place. We're also looking to provide four more spaces at the very end of the pavement area today, more or less towards the easterly end of the building. And the reason is that there's going to be a tenant, a smaller tenant in that area. It would be convenient to have at least four spaces over for them in that area. So that's the gist of our proposal. There are no other building improvements being proposed at this point in time, nor utilities or otherwise. Fairly modest proposal in scale. So with that, I turn it back to the board for any questions.
Great, thank you. This item also has the opportunity for public comment this evening. If there's anybody here who would like to make public comment, we ask them to do so at this time. Seeing none, I'll turn it over to the board.
Mr. Bavar.
Thank you.
How would they access those parking spaces beyond the building?
Currently, there is an access right between these two properties that will be.
It's off-site.
It's off-site. It has to come through. There's a driveway right here that goes into this little existing parking area. It goes around the side of the building or end of the building outside.
I noticed next to those new parking spaces, there's propane tanks. Right. Will there be some kind of barrier or fence?
There's a little fence around it.
There is. Right. I guess that's all I have.
Thank you, Dave. Nick?
I have no questions.
Susan?
I went down because I was one of those people who really did not have a clue where Commercial Road was. And still didn't know where Commercial Road was because there's no road sign for Commercial Road. And I was told by our planner that that's the responsibility of what, Jay? Town DOT? I mean.
If being a town road, which I believe it is, if it's
town road?
Yep. It's the town's responsibility.
I think that outside letting people know where Commercial Road is not a bad idea. Not that that's up to the applicant, but just make a note that somebody in the town will give them a road sign. I don't have any problems with this. I just think it's one of those things that's a good sign that one use is turning into another use rather than one use leaving and the building will remain unused. I think that's excellent. Thank you.
Thank you. John?
Good. Hope we get the sanitation approval for the connection on Pond Road. Pond.
Okay.
Yeah, I guess my only question is whether, and I apologize if this was pointed out earlier, so I didn't catch it. Has there been any discussion yet with the sanitary district, or are they sort of being, brought into the loop in parallel?
Glad you brought it up. I forgot completely to say anything about it. The district meets on the fourth Thursday of the month, and we'll be appearing before them at that time for this connection. As Jay had pointed out, an older on-site septic system. I want to get rid of that and make a connection. The district has given us an initial, at least Mr. Hughes has for the district, an initial gap that seems feasible and possible to make a connection from the back of the building here. We have to go cross-country over to Pond View, so we have a couple of easements that need to be in place. One is from the Portland Water District, and they've given us essentially a thumbs up into offering an easement agreement for a force main sewer, and then I believe his name is Mr. Espy, needs to provide an easement, and my client has approached him, and he seems very amenable to providing that as well. So the connection would be into this so-called low-pressure sewer system that was installed a number of years ago at Pondview that serves all the folks. Everybody has a little individual, what they call it, a vendor product, E1 pump station, serving each of those facilities. And then that force main has a 2-inch line, goes up Pondview to Pleasant Hill Road, goes across the street to, the name of the road, the private drive that Big Brady has on the other side before you get to Al's Variety. That's where there's a terminus and ties into the gravity sewer system that the district maintains there. So this is all part of the district's sewer system, and so they would provide the approval for that. So we hope on the fourth Thursday of the month here that we'll get an approval from them.
Okay. Thanks. In terms of easement,
to have an easement for access to the parking spaces that we were proposing in the back of the building, since that drive is not on the property?
I understand that that is a condition of the sale, that goes along with the deed. Unfortunately, I didn't provide any particular evidence about that, but that's my understanding, that there is an easement in place now for that. In fact, I believe all of these buildings were originally constructed by McGrady's, so they had that cross easement access inherent in them already. They were their original owners. That will be part of the sale, so there'll be access to the back of the building.
So I would like to make a motion to approve the application of Three Commercial LLC for the amended site plan of Three Commercial Road for the expansion of the parking areas and sewer connection as depicted on the plan dated 4/28/14. Prior to the start of construction, the applicant shall provide a capacity to serve letter to the planning department from the sanitary district. They shall also provide evidence of all required easements to the planning department. Is there a second?
Do you have a second? Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
All easements, is clear in that that we mean the easement to be able to construct the site, the parking on the other side of the building, as well as all the easements for the sewer system? Is that clear?
That
it means all those?
That's what I'm talking about. The easements that are required in order to get the force main sewer to the low pressure main.
Right.
And the easement that supposedly is part of the
I just want to make sure you don't have to write all that out.
Right.
Okay.
So
I think it's picked up in the discussion.
Okay. So okay. Good. Yep. Thank you.
So all in favor? I show that to be unanimous.
All right, now to the members of the board. As Mr. Chase tried to explain to us why he thought that the applicant for Piper Shores was not here when that item came up on the agenda, is the board comfortable with discussing that item at this time?
Yes.
All right. So do we need a formal untabling?
No.
Or do we just move on?
My rules expert.
We need a motion to remove the table. All right, so I'm going to motion that we remove the tabling that we earlier put in place. Move the prior motion.
All right.
Second.
We have a second. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? We're good to go.
All right. So Piper Shores, Maine Life Care Community Retirement, Inc. requests a site plan amendment for improvements to the generator system at the site on Piper Road. Mr. Chase.
Sure, I'll keep my brief introduction in three persons. I've already given it once. But again, the applicant is seeking approval to expand the existing generator pad and to construct a shed to house the electrical components associated with the generator. Again, given that this site is subject to a contract zone approval, all site plan amendments are required to come back to the board for approval. That I turn it back to you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chase, and good evening.
Hi there. Mike Tadema-Wheeland from FST. We appreciate the board considering hearing us. We apologize for our tardiness. In addition to the items that were tabled, I think the change of venue kind of threw us off a little bit too. But we appreciate it nonetheless. I'm here with Kevin Eames, the facilities director from Piper Shores. And they're proposing, like Jay mentioned, some upgrades to their emergency power generation system. Currently, the healthcare facility and some of the assisted living units, or all the assisted living units, have emergency power supplied by a generator located to the west of the main entrance. The generator is housed in an open top wood frame screening enclosure. Its siding matches that of the building, which is sort of a cream colored shake appearance. So the proposed project will then also provide emergency power to 160 independent living units. And to do so, they'll replace the generator unit itself. In order to do so, the existing enclosure and the slab that the existing generator is on will be expanded a few feet, and a 200 square foot or thereabouts electrical equipment building will be placed in the vicinity to house the transfer switches and such. This area of the site is quite tight. There's not a lot of room over there. In order to locate it sort of efficiently and keep costs down from running long distances with underground electric, it needs to be located sort of in the vicinity of the generator. So in doing so, two existing parking spaces will be lost. In the cover letter, we provided sort of an accounting of the required parking under the contract zone, which is 257 spaces. Currently, there's 281 spaces on the site, and after all is said and done, there'll be 279, so there'll be a surplus of 22 spaces over what's required by the ordinance after the project is complete. Talk a little bit about the design. It's pretty simple. The materials on the electrical equipment building will match in style and in color to both the main building as well as the existing enclosure that's there. An existing light pole will have to move over slightly, 15 feet. And again, two parking spaces will be lost, and the grant curving that's there today will be sort of reconfigured around the generator. Some landscape plantings will be placed alongside the generator. The intent is to make it blend in with sort of existing development over there, provide some screening and some color with the plantings. So with that, we'll turn it over to the board and answer any questions there are.
All right, thank you. And again, we have the opportunity for public comment this evening. If there's anybody who would like to make public comment, please do so at this time. Seeing none, I'll turn it back to the board. Mr. Phillips.
Thank you. Seems fairly straightforward, and in principle, I'm okay with the parking impact, but beyond the ordinance requirement, was there a sort of a functional look at parking demand and whether that might create an impact?
Yeah, there is. Well, there has been throughout the years. You may recall a year ago we were before you requesting an expansion of 10 spaces. That's helped quite a bit. The loss of two spaces, it's seen as acceptable by the Piper Shores. Again, the need to sort of locate that building in the vicinity of the generator and just the tightness of that area on site necessitated that. But it's a loss of two spaces, but it's acceptable by Piper Shores. They don't see that's going to be a great issue.
Okay, yeah, you mentioned the past request, and that was part of what I had in mind. I couldn't remember exactly what the circumstances were or what the numbers were, but I had this vague memory that we were going in the other direction last time. So, beyond that, I guess I really don't have a concern with that. It's a little bit more pervy surface, I guess, but it's basically negligible, and I understand that, particularly with a facility of this type, that it's important to have the right type of backup power.
Yeah, I think if I mean, it's actually a wash in pervious area. We're eliminating 200 square feet of parking and adding 200 square feet of roof, but I agree.
Okay,
we're talking small numbers here in the grand scheme of things.
Yeah, no, you're right. I was focused on the increase in the size of the slab. But okay, that's all I've got. Thanks.
Thanks, Corey. John?
I agree with Corey very much. No problem with it all.
Thank you. Susan?
In theory, I have no problems with this either. But I live just down the road. It's a good thing I don't have anybody there because they're never supposed to park. I think this is an opportunity for me to say, you're going to be coming back to us with some kind of a concept plan on what you're going to do about parking, because I'm not going to ask you to get into it with me tonight, but it's going to happen, right? It's going to have to happen. In the meantime, these two sites, these two spots are not going to create that problem. So that's why I'm agreeing.
Thank you.
Okay.
Ray, no comment.
Hey, I just have one question that probably makes no difference at all, but I'm curious as to why you're removing the tree in the landscape area to the left of the new building.
Yeah, it has to do with constructability as well as underground power, the new underground power coming into that building. It's something that Pepper Shores didn't want to have to do. It's a nice tree. They are going to sort of replace it with some more appropriate landscaping in that area.
At the risk of being awkward, possibly, conduit bends.
That's true. As does Pepper Shores, yeah. Kevin came from.
Thank you for bringing it up. Kevin Hughes, Facilities Director. I actually met with an arborist today. There was a beautiful tree there, and my objective is to try to keep that tree. The problem is, what's not depicted on this drawing is there are two main transformers, and that's where we're going to run the conductors, underneath the ground into the switchgear room, which is the new shed. So we're looking at trying to see how we can route those conduits underground to save that tree. So the arborist gave me some ideas. When we start excavating, one of the things we'll do is we'll try to sever the roots off in a manner that will hopefully save the tree. We'll do our best. That's our goal. If we can't get the radius of bend for the conduits, then we are going to have to remove that tree, unfortunately. We're doing everything we possibly can to avoid it.
Yeah, because I mean, we've got equipment now. We can go under roads and pull sewer mains and do all kinds of things. If there's any way that we can save, I do know the tree. That's why I'm bringing it up.
It is a beautiful tree. Just so that you're aware, there are two transformers, and one of them is going to have to remain live during the process. So if we can get under that safely and bypass it, but if the roots of that tree are in the way, we'll definitely have to remove
the tree. I was just curious.
It's a big, very good question. Thank you.
Yes. I get it. Any other comments or concerns of the board? All right, seeing none, I'm going to move to approve the application of Maine Life Retirement Community, Inc. for the amended site plan of Piper Shores for the expansion of the existing generator pad and addition of an electrical equipment building as depicted on the plan dated 4/24/14. All relevant prior conditions of approval shall continue to pertain. Is there a second?
Second.
We have a second. Is there any comments?
Seeing none, all in favor? Thank you very much. Save the tree.
I'll try. Thank you very much.
All right. Town planner report, Mr. Chase.
I have nothing to report this evening.
Thank you. An administrative amendment report.
I have no administrative amendments to report.
All right. With that in mind, I would like to make other members of the board aware that Mr. Chase and I are working with the architectural firm on the rock climbing gym, as they have proposed a potential different outside material for that building. And again, I make you aware of it. If you have concerns, please contact me, but I think that we're on to something very, very compatible. So I think you might. But I do want to make the board aware of that, and we're not taking this lightly in any way, shape, or fashion. But if anybody does have a concern, please see me, and I'll be more than happy to discuss that item with you, Mr. Chase.
I'll just note that they should probably contact me directly rather than have a discussion with you outside of the applicant being present, as that could be mistaken as ex parte communications, and I hate to throw any work that we're doing under into question.
Thank you for pointing that out. I appreciate that.
I appreciate what you're trying to do.
All right. Okay. Now, we don't want to do it wrong. We want to do it right. So contact Mr. Chase if you have any questions. Any correspondence this evening?
We already discussed it. We don't get through it.
All right.
Hopefully that'll change.
All right. Planning board comments. Yes, David.
Chairman, for you to be able to identify a specific tree, I think speaks volumes to your experience and knowledge.
Well, thank you. I've been to the site on multiple occasions, and I've had the opportunity to walk around, so I know the general area. So, anything else? All right, no other comments. At this point, I would accept a motion to adjourn. Is there a section? A second, excuse me. Do we have a second? All those in favor? And good evening.
We have two arguments to sign.